Good morning, everyone. Welcome to this invited symposium on core stability. My name is Jaap van Dieën. I'm from the VU University Amsterdam. In this symposium, we have two excellent speakers, Ajit Chaudhary and Jacek Cholowicki, and we have myself. And what's worse, my co-chair isn't here, so I'll have to time myself, but I hope it will work out fine. I'm not going to say much in general about this symposium because the introduction sort of will follow in my presentation. Suffices to say that core stability has become a very popular topic in sports science and actually also in rehabilitation. However, if you read the literature on core stability, what stands out really is that a lot of people are using that term, but they're all using it to refer to different things. And what we, I think, are trying to show in this symposium is how we can define core stability in a more coherent way, and also that a lot of these things that people call core stability are related to it, but are not core stability in itself. So I hope that will become clear during the talks. So the first talk, what I'm going to try to do is set the stage by giving you sort of a conceptual framework of the concept core stability. But let's start at how this is actually used in literature. And I've just copied a number of figures from different papers that use the term core stability. And these are measurements that were actually done by Jacek Cholowicki. What they measure is a sudden release. So the subject is pulling on that cable, is suddenly released, and they measure the responses, and it's referred to as core stability or trunk stability. This is another study by Leetun et al. What they're doing is they're measuring abduction force of the hip, abductor muscles. They're measuring endurance of trunk muscles. And again, they're referring to it as core stability, but it's clearly a completely different measurement. If you look at the training literature, some people will call this a core stability exercise. Others will call this a core stability exercise. Actually, this person is trying to selectively recruit one of the trunk muscles. In a still fairly recent review, Borghuis et al. Concluded that it's a hot topic, but a vague, they concluded it's a hot topic, but a vague concept. So that's in a way kind of worrying. And I think it doesn't need to be that vague. First of all, let's look at the term core. What does core mean? Well, I think it's very simple. People usually refer to the core as the trunk. And then there's some debate as whether the hips and the pelvis are still part of that, but that's all. So we have a clear anatomical term for that, actually. So I would suggest to replace core by trunk. Then we all know what we're talking about. But the difficult part really is the stability. And I guess everyone sort of agrees that stability has something to do with the ability to deal with perturbations. And in this context, it's most relevant, I think, to think about mechanical perturbations, but actually you can also think about perturbations to the structure of the musculoskeletal system. But let's focus on the mechanical perturbations. So here we have, well, something that represents the trunk in this presentation, the spine, which is supported by the pelvis. So the perturbations could be, say, a push on the shoulder, a pull on the arm, or a push against the pelvis, or maybe the forces induced by landing on one leg. All of those would lead to a perturbation of the equilibrium of this system, and the trunk would bend towards the right in this view due to each of these perturbations. So these perturbations can basically come from everywhere, and we can also say that they're always present. There are always perturbations around, if only our own breathing would perturb our trunk posture. So what's the problem here? Well, we have a very simple model here now of the trunk. So this is where the pelvis is. We have one point of rotation, one center of rotation, and we have a single inverted pendulum on top of that. So we model the trunk as a single inverted pendulum, a stick with the mast located in the middle of the stick, or the center of mast located in the middle. And of course, theoretically, if this is upright, it's in equilibrium. Gravity is acting down, there's a reaction force in the center of rotation acting up, and they're both canceling, and they don't create any moments. So it's in static equilibrium. However, the slightest perturbation will cause the pendulum to move into, well, in this case, the right direction, and now gravity will start to exert a moment that will pull it further in the direction of the perturbation. So the moment grows with the change in angle, change with the perturbation itself. So we have a positive derivative, and it means that the pendulum will fall over. It's unstable. Now, that is a fairly rigid definition of stability, and it also makes clear that it's a dichotomous concept. So something is either stable or unstable, and an inverted pendulum is unstable. Now, an unstable system is totally uninteresting. It can't function because the slightest perturbation will throw it over. So, to stabilize a system like this, well, in engineering, you could come up with a very simple solution. We'll connect a spring to the inverted pendulum with a moment arm B, and now when the pendulum is perturbed, the spring is stretched and will exert a force, Fs here, the spring force. And if the moment created by that spring is large enough, if it exceeds the moment created by gravity, it will pull the pendulum back to its original position, and the system is stable. So to show you this a little bit differently, here we have a pendulum standing upright. This is a model simulation of this inverted pendulum. You see the same thing here. The angle is zero. It's standing upright. It's perturbed. At time is half a second here. And then it starts to move towards the right. You see the gray lines here, which are some arbitrary time frames. But it ends in a minus 90 degrees position flat on the floor. So that's the unstable system. So this is with a spring stiffness of zero. Now we connect a spring to the inverted pendulum. We push it in the same direction, and what you see is that it's pulled back and it starts to oscillate around the original position, as you can also see here. So now we have a stable system, it no longer falls over. We can increase the spring stiffness even more, and what you can see is that the frequency of the oscillations increases, but the amplitude of the oscillations decreases. Here the amplitude is on a scale of 10 degrees. Here the amplitude is on a scale of 2 degrees. So increasing the stiffness would, well, in this, from this to that system, make it stable, but also it limits, for the stable system, it limits the displacement that it undergoes for a given perturbation. So this one is unstable, the displacement grows, and it's independent of the initial perturbation. These are stable, the displacements are bounded. But obviously, if you have a spring only, and again, this is in a theoretical model, it would oscillate forever. There's no energy loss, so it just keeps on moving. In real life, it will stop oscillating at some point, because there's always energy losses. But you want that energy to be dissipated quite fast, because, of course, these oscillations will hinder you when you're performing functional movements. So the other thing you need to stabilize a system like this, to control a system like this, rather, is to have some damping. And damping is resistance against velocity, and it basically dissipates energy. So here we have the same system again, oscillating without any damping. Then we add some damping, and we see that the oscillations become smaller and then disappear. If we increase the damping, they disappear a lot faster. So if we look at a stable system, it starts to become interesting, because this system, of course, works better than this one, which is in turn better than this one. This is what we call the performance of the system. It's the rate of return to the initial state. So if we have adequate damping and stiffness, we have a high performance, it will return quickly to its initial state after a perturbation, and it allows control with a larger precision, because the oscillations are small and vanish fairly soon. There's another aspect of the control of a stable system, so we're not talking about stability or instability, but once we have a stable system, there is another aspect which is important, and that's how large a perturbation can you actually deal with. So if we increase the perturbation magnitude for given stiffness and damping, what we see is that at some point the perturbation will be so large that the system will again fall over to 90 degrees. So depending on the stiffness and damping in that system, that largest perturbation will be larger. So if the stiffness and damping are higher, the larger the perturbation that can be endured, so the higher the robustness. So robustness indicates the largest perturbation that can be handled, or the margin of safety from becoming unstable, if you wish. So this is all in models. Now let's focus on the trunk again. So if we have the trunk, the first thing we can think about as a sort of, let's say, the biological analogy of the spring would be the ligaments and the intervertebral disc, the passive joint structures that connect the bones to each other. So if we have a perturbation here, what happens is these ligaments will be stretched and will tend to pull the system back to its original state. However, for the human spine, the ligaments are not stiff enough to passively stabilize that system under the load of the own upper body mass. So it's not enough. We need something more. And the other thing we have as a spring-like system is actually the muscles that connect the bones. And again, if we stretch them, they will produce a bit more force, and they will pull back the system to its original state. So the biological structures and processes that provide stiffness and damping are the passive joint structures and the muscles. But of course, muscles are controlled by the nervous system, and that makes them a very flexible system. And we actually have, you could say, three modes of controlling muscles that contribute to the control of the trunk. We can anticipate a perturbation by co-contracting muscles. We can anticipate very specifically if we know what's going to happen. We can, for example, already contract muscles that will counteract the effect of the perturbation. And we can use feedback. So once the perturbation has occurred, we can measure its effects and then control the system to reduce the effect of that perturbation. So in our trunk system, we have muscles and passive tissues that provide feedback in a way that provide immediate correction of any perturbation caused by the environment. So we have a loop here where the stiffness of the system corrects itself. But what we can do is when we know that environment, when we have some knowledge of the environment, we can send motor commands down to the muscles again that can either increase the stiffness of the muscles just by co-contracting the muscles, or that can counteract the perturbation quite specific. And to show you that this is indeed what we're doing in daily life, I have a small example from one experiment. In this experiment, we had people lift boxes. They were standing upright, as illustrated here, holding the handles of a box. And the box was quite wide, 1.2 meters wide, and there could be a weight either in the left compartment, the center, or the right compartment. And we had conditions in which the subject could see where the weight was placed, and conditions where they were not able to see the box, where there was a curtain in between them and the box. So we measured the forces at the handles, which is illustrated here, the vertical force exerted on the handle in purple. And what you can see here is just before that force is exerted, trunk muscle activity starts. So this is a self-induced perturbation, of course. The box will perturb the equilibrium of the trunk. The box mass will pull the trunk forward, but it's completely self-induced. So we can anticipate by contracting extensor muscles, in this case, before the perturbation occurs. The same thing happens when you throw someone a ball. They will activate muscles counteracting that perturbation before actually catching the ball. Now, this is what happens when we vary the condition of load knowledge. So here we have the position of the load on the x-axis and the normalized EMG activity before the onset of force on the box, so before they start lifting. And what you see, if they don't know the center of mass position, so with the curtain there, the left and right muscles are equally active and the activity is not modulated with the center of mass position. So basically they're co-contracting muscles on both sides of the spine to increase the stiffness of that system to be able to deal with the upcoming perturbation of which they don't know the direction. So it's an unknown, it's an expected but unknown perturbation. In this case, the perturbation is known and expected, and what we see is that the activity of the muscles is modulated in relation to the position of the center of mass. So when the center of mass is to the left, the right muscles are more active. When it's to the right, the left muscles are more active. So completely in line with the mechanical perturbation that's expected. So one of our lines of defense against perturbations is anticipation. The second, because we don't always see the perturbation coming, is feedback. And when we think about feedback control, we usually think about loops like this. Proprioceptive feedback from muscle spindles or from ligament receptors to the spinal level, feeding back directly to the muscles. It's a very fast loop and it's very important, but it's of course not the only thing. When we perturb trunk posture, this also generates usually tactile information, often also vestibular information, because the head, after all, is attached to the trunk, so it will start moving with the trunk, which also creates a visual flow, so there is visual information. And all that information is integrated and again used for feedback control to the muscles down there. And also, proprioceptive feedback is integrated into that whole system. The nice thing about this is a slow loop. But the nice thing of it is that we can actually weigh that information, so we can use information that is more relevant in a given context or that is more reliable in a given context. One final thing to mention there is that also the task or the goal that the person has will influence how this information is used, and I'll show some examples of that. Important to mention again, these are slow feedback loops, and these ones down here are very fast. And the speed of a feedback loop is extremely important, as I will again show with an illustration of a simulation. So here we have again an inverted pendulum with some stiffness and damping, but now the stiffness and damping are activated with some delay. The blue line here is without any delay, and then the red line is with a delay of only 20 milliseconds. And as you can see, the performance of that system becomes worse. The oscillations vanish less rapidly and they're slightly bigger to begin with. So a delayed system has a worse performance than a zero delay system. If I increase that delay to 40 milliseconds, the oscillations actually stay, they don't go anymore. And if we increase it a bit more to 60 milliseconds, the oscillations grow and the system is again unstable. So you want rapid feedback. Nevertheless, the slow feedback processes, when acting on top of rapid feedback, can be very useful. So the next step will be to have a look at how sensory modalities are then used in feedback control of the trunk. And recently we did an experiment to probe those sensory modalities. So what we did is we had people sit on a stable chair and an unstable chair. So the unstable chair looked something like this. It could rotate freely in the frontal plane, and people had to balance that. And during that, we applied sensory perturbations. We applied vestibular stimulation at 0.25 hertz. And basically what you do is you pass a current behind the ears that stimulates the vestibular afferents, and it makes people sway from left to right if you alternate the direction of that current. We also used a tactile stimulus. They were touching the arm of a robot that they were not able to see. It was placed to the side of them and they were looking straight ahead. And that was moving again at 0.25 hertz with a very light touch contact there. And the final thing is we manipulated the proprioceptive information by inducing muscle vibration on the paraspinal muscles, oscillating between left and right paraspinal muscles, again at 0.25 hertz. And then we looked at trunk acceleration in general and at trunk acceleration at 0.25 hertz specifically. So these are typical results. This is without perturbation on a stable surface, the acceleration of the trunk in the medial lateral direction. So there's not much happening. If the subject closes the eyes, that's the other manipulation we did, there's a bit more sway, but not a whole lot. Then with the muscle vibration, you see sway occurring, and you can also see it's quite rhythmical. It actually occurs at the 0.25 hertz, as is shown in the power spectrum of the acceleration here. This is with GVS, and this is with the tactile stimulus. And this is on the unstable surface. Obviously, sway is a lot larger to begin with, but also the effects of the perturbations change. And for that, it's easier to go to this slide. This is the relative effect of the sensory perturbation. So closing your eyes has a small effect on the stable surface, but has a huge effect when you're on an unstable surface. Muscle vibration has a substantial effect on a stable surface, but a somewhat smaller effect on an unstable surface. Vestibular stimulation, again, more important on the unstable than on the stable surface, and tactile, again, the opposite. So we have a highly flexible system here. We put someone from a stable system in an unstable environment, and they completely change their behavior. They start using sensory information in a different way. So again, showing that slide, the weighting of the information changes depending on the environmental context. So trunk control, the determinants of stability and performance and robustness, quality of the control, if you wish, are basically stiffness and damping. And they, in a biological system, depend on the mechanical properties of joint structures, on the muscle strength, of course, because that determines how we can apply corrective torques to that system. And then also on muscle endurance, because if you want to apply those corrective torques again, still at the end of an exhaustive event, this is also important. It also depends on the contraction dynamics, how fast can you build up the force. But it also depends on anticipation and so on, cognitive abilities. The delays are important, so neural propagation and transmission, thresholds of sensors, excitability of the alpha motor neurons, activation dynamics of the muscles. How well can you measure the errors, so the acuity of the sensory system? And then how well do you integrate all that information and how well do you translate that to corrective commands, so these sensory motor skills. So from, let's say, a very simple system with a spring and damper, I think we have to move on to a very complex system with a lot of different determinants that play into that. So people that measure muscle strength and call it core stability do have a point. They're measuring a determinant of core control, maybe better, but they're not measuring core stability itself. One final point I would like to make is that the task goal is also very important, and this is an illustration of that. Again, a recent experiment, we had subjects sitting on a platform. The platform was oscillating in an unpredictable way, back and forth, and we had two conditions, four conditions. They were told to either resist trunk movement, or they got no specific instruction. And the other thing is they were told to close their eyes or to keep their eyes open. Here we see the ratio of the translation of the upper trunk relative to the platform. And you can see it's about one, so that means that they're holding their trunk still relative to the platform, so relative to the pelvis, which is fixed to the platform. Red is the resist task, where they're successful at higher frequency still to keep their trunk immobile, but then if we increase the frequency even more, they start moving relative to the platform. Most interesting thing here is when they open their eyes, what we see here is the relative translation, that's the translation of the trunk relative to the pelvis, When they open their eyes, we see a phase difference between those movements, which means they're actually moving opposite to their own pelvis. So they're not trying to hold their trunk still anymore. They're actually trying to hold their head still in space. And that, I think, brings me to my last slide. Ooh, I wasn't expecting the sounds, but... So here we see maybe sort of the classical approach to core stability. The blue judoka is trying to pull the other judoka's trunk out of position to then throw him on the ground. And here we see the other task. This person is trying to stabilize the position of the head in space. So both this white judoka and the skier here need excellent trunk control, but they're doing completely different things. So it's not a single task, it's very different tasks that are subserved by the same system. With that, I would like to thank you, and well, special thanks to some of the people that have contributed to these experiments and our main funding agency for this line of work. Thank you.